About the Imam alayhi salam in the time of ghaiba. How does al-Imam live? Many people wonder. Where does he live? Does he have children? Does he get married? What's his state? Because we have hadith that the Imam is in a constant state of fear, anxiety. Why? On the one hand, al-Imam al-Mahdi ajjalallahu ta'ala faraja is completely satisfied with his closeness to Allah. Even if the people abandon him, the Imam alayhi salam makes it very clear that this does not hurt us in any way, the Ahlul Bayt. If people abandon us, if the world stands against us, we have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Imam alayhi salam doesn't need us. Don't ever think that the Mahdi needs us. The Imam alayhi salam is here only to guide us. Otherwise they're really busy. They really are busy with their relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'd like to share with you a letter by Imam al-Mahdi, which Al-Alam Al-Majlisi narrates in Bihar Al-Anwar, volume 53, page 178. It's also in the book of Al-Ihtijaj, page 496. A group of people, they were discussing something about the Mahdi. Some of them, you know, approved that point, some of them didn't. It's a long story, but here's the point. So they sent a letter to the Imam alayhi salam through one of his ambassadors. The Imam alayhi salam states the following. It's very bone chilling when you hear the response of the Mahdi. The Imam alayhi salam, he addresses their questions and then he says, وَلَوْلَا مَا عِنْدَنَا مِنْ مَحَبَّةِ صَلَاحِكُمْ وَرَحْمَتِكُمْ. If it weren't for our love and concern for you, Ahlul Bayt, وَالْإِشْفَاقِ عَلَيْكُمْ, our absolute compassion for you, لَكُنَّا عَنْ مُخَاطَبَتِكُمْ فِي شُغْلِ. The Imam alayhi salam says, we the Ahlul Bayt were so busy with God's plan and our relationship with Allah and our own affairs, we don't even have time to address you. But the only reason why we address you and are concerned about you is because of our love for you. Think about it for a moment. Way before this physical universe, Allah created the light of Ahlul Bayt. They were surrounding the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who are we? Who do we think we are? The Imam alayhi salam is humbly stating that, look, we're busy with Allah. We don't even have time to speak to you. The only reason why we do is because we love you, we care about you. Otherwise, we don't need you. You're the ones who need us. Sometimes we think it's the other way around. So the Imam alayhi salam does not need anyone. And in another beautiful letter, the Imam alayhi salam clearly states that he is completely satisfied with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Shaykh al-Tusi narrates this in his book Al-Ghaybah, page 285, إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَنَا, Allah is with us. وَلَا فَاقَتَ بِنَا إِلَىٰ غَيْرَ. So when we have Allah, we don't need anyone else. وَالْحَقُّ مَعَنَا, and the truth is with us. When you have Allah and you have the truth, what else do you need? فَلَنْ يُحِشَنَا مَنْ قَعَدَ عَنَا. Don't think it will make us lonely if people betray us and they don't support us. So on the one hand, the Imam alayhi salam at the time of ghaibah, he's completely satisfied with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has Allah, he has the truth, he doesn't need anything. But on the other hand, we have hadiths that depict the situation of the Imam alayhi salam as being miserable. State of constant fear and state of constant anxiety. I'll share with you two, three examples. You're all familiar with dua al-nudbah. When you're intimately and emotionally addressing al-Imam al-Mahdi, in one passage we say, أَيْنَ الْمُضْطَرُّ الَّذِي يُجَابُ إِذَا دَعَى. Where is the distressed one? When he calls to Allah, Allah quickly answers him. But you see how dua al-nudbah describes al-Imam al-Mahdi? Where is the distressed one? That means the Imam is in a constant state of distress. عَزِيزٌ عَلَيَّ أَن تُحِيطَ بِكَ دُونِيَ الْبَلْوَى وَلَا يَنَالُكَ مِنِّي ضَجِيجٌ وَلَا شَكْوَى. Oh Imam, it's very heavy upon me that you're surrounded with balwa, with trials, with difficulties, with tragedies, and I don't cry for you the way I should cry. So see, we have these two passages in Dua al-Nudbah that clearly state the Imam alayhi salam is in a state of distress. In another hadith, in the salawats that we offer on the Mahdi after his ziyarah, Allahumma salli ala hujjatika fi ardik, O Allah, send your prayers and blessings on your proof on earth, wa khalifatika fi biladik, and your caliph on earth. Al-mutaraqib al-khaif. One attribute of the Mahdi is that he's khaif. He's in the state of fear at the time of the ghaibah. In fact, we have a hadith that states al-Mahdi has similarities with all prophets of God. The similarity that he has with Prophet Musa alayhi salam is that Prophet Musa, when that incident happened and one of his people killed one of the Pharaoh's people, and the Quran describes him fleeing the city of Pharaoh in what state? خَائِفًا يَتَرَقَّبْ. He was in the state of fear because they were after him to kill him. So question, why is the Imam in the state of fear? The Imam in one hadith, he just says, we're with Allah and we're safe with Allah and we don't need anybody else. So why is he in the state of fear and anxiety? Scholars have given the following possibilities. Number one, his state of khawf and fear is for his followers. His Shias, because he knows they have so many enemies. Every day there are governments, people plotting, conspiring to bring the Shia down. And that pains the Imam. When you see your followers suffering, attacked left and right throughout history, that really hurts you. And that really creates anxiety in you. Number two, when you look at human suffering, if you go and see a child suffering, people getting killed, women being displaced, believe me, you can't sleep, you can't eat, you can't do anything. Imam al-Mahdi, for over 1,000 years, he's witnessing human suffering. You think he's restless? You think he can rest? He's restless because he's witnessing all the injustice that's happening. Number three, he sees people in the name of religion destroying religion. That hurts him because this is the religion of his grandfather, Rasulullah. People, others are hijacking this religion, and then in the name of Islam, they're spreading injustice around the world. This hurts the Imam. Number four, he remembers the tragedies of his grandfathers. Doesn't he? In Ziyarat al-Nahiya states, I will cry blood for Imam al-Husayn. Number five, when he sees his followers sinning, that really creates a lot of pain in the heart of the Imam. And number six, the Imam's always on the lookout. Remember, throughout history, governments, people, and be sure that today, there are intelligence agencies looking for the Mahdi. So while the Mahdi is protected by God, but he has to have that natural concern about his life. So he's always going from one place to another place. He's always protecting himself. And that is a state of constant fear and anxiety. And that's only natural. And this actually tells you that moderate fear is good. See, if someone has no fear, they're reckless. When you're dealing with something serious, you have to have fear. The ghaibah is something very serious. The tragedies at the time of ghaibah are serious tragedies. When you have a state of fear, that indicates what? That you're serious. See, if you have an interview, and you're going to that interview, and it's the interview that will decide your fate and future, you're confident. I know exactly what to answer. I'm qualified, I have the best resume, I'm fit for this job. But at night you're anxious. Why?
It's serious.
Because it's serious. In fact, if you were to be in a jokeful mood and just, you know, not showing any seriousness, people will say, you know what, that's not appropriate. It's an important meaning. You should act serious. See, fear indicates seriousness if it's moderate, of course. If it's excessive, it's wrong. So when the Imam is in the state of fear, that means he's serious about what's happening. That's how probably we can describe that. I'll give you one interesting example. Especially this happens with some Middle Eastern families, like Arab moms. Have you seen that sometimes when, let me give you the scenario. A son comes to his mom. He's just had a very bad accident. So he comes to her and he tells her, mother, look at me, I'm completely safe. Not a scratch on my body. So she sees him safe. Okay, well, why? What happened? He's like, look at my car. Look at the accident that happened. The minute she sees that car accident, what happens to her?
She probably drops.
But why? Why does she drop? He's safe and sound in front of her, not a trace of anything on his body, not a scratch, no blood. But why does she drop? See, she has no doubt that he's safe. I mean, he's talking to her in front of her. She sees his body. He's completely safe. But why does she drop? See, because of the seriousness of the incident. When you're dealing with something serious, even though you have 100% knowledge that everything's fine, but the seriousness of the incident makes you in the state of anxiety and fear. And so those hadiths that describe the Mahdi in the state of anxiety and fear, some scholars say this is how we can understand them. We can understand them by knowing that the Imam is taking these events very seriously. Every human life that is killed unjustly is